I heard that ducks have one hole. I don't know if you know that, but ducks have one hole. And they pee out of it, and they shit out of it, they get in it, and they lay eggs out of it. That has got to be one smelly, dirty hole. That hole has got to be a pretty awful place. I feel a little bad for the man duck, because ducks are monogamous. I don't know if you know that, but ducks stay in their relationships forever, and by the time that duck gets to be 48, her husband must be like, dude, that shit sucks. I hate it. And then he goes and f***s a swan or something. His wife's like, why are you swan for? She's got an asshole. That's why. She's got an asshole. Okay? I got a green head. I don't know what that means. Just somehow, they got green heads. They deserve more. Speaking of animal-type humor that's not totally finished, I have this joke, like a, you know, animals talking to each other type joke, that I don't know how to finish it. I know what's funny about it, but I don't know how to finish it. Basically, it's about a lion who goes up to a giraffe, and he says, hey, man, did you see that dude? And the giraffe's like, what dude? And he goes, he's that dude. He lives by the river in a hut. And the giraffe goes, what does he look like? And the lion goes, he looks like this. Ah! And the giraffe's like, well, I know a dude that lives by the river, but he doesn't look like that. He goes, no, that's what he looks like. Ah! The giraffe says, I know a guy, but he looks like this. See, the lion just thinks that people look like that. The lion doesn't get that he makes a person look like that by scaring the shit out of him. He just thinks that, hey, that's that dude that's always going, ah! That's who, what he's like. I was on an airplane and there was a Hasidic Jewish man trying to put an enormous bag under the seat. It doesn't matter that he was Hasidic, but it's a detail. It's detail. When you try to put enormous bags under seats, folks notice the kind of person you are. They make note. They say some Chinese guy, whatever you are, they're going to describe you. They're not just going to say, a man put a little giant thing under his seat. What kind of man? It's not important. Just a fellow. No, this guy. Trying to shove this thing under the seat. No one can leave because he's not going to not do it. And the flight attendant was a guy. And I'm not going to say he was gay because that's not important. It doesn't enter into the story. I'm going to call the Jewish guy a Jewish guy. And I'm going to call the gay guy just some guy. How do you like that? Isn't that unfair? I'm not going to identify him as gay, because I don't want to discredit them. Actually, he didn't do anything wrong. So, boy, this what a disaster this is right now. Jewish guy trying to put the thing under the seat, and the guy's going, sir, it's not going to fit. He was only slightly gay, like that. He wasn't like, sir, it's not going to fit. Ah! No, he just said, sir, it's not gonna fit.
It's going to fit. I know it's going to fit. It's going to fit. I'm telling you, Moses.
Okay, here's the thing. I have two children, and the thing that scares me the most is that they disappear. Nothing that scares me most more than them disappearing. That's every parent's worst fear. Now, why do kids disappear sometimes? I think it's because somebody took them and had sex with them. And once you have sex with a kid, you gotta toss them, because people hate folks who have sex with kids more than pretty much anything. If you murder somebody, folks will find you a reason. Ah, you were upset, you didn't have, you were dehydrated, whatever. So here's the thing. So if you have sex with a kid, you got to chuck them out, because if the kid tells anybody, you're screwed. I can't help thinking that if we could take down a few notches the hatred for kid having sex people, at least you get the kid back. That's what I'm trying to say, is that the guy could just call you, hey, I just kid, you want me to bring him to soccer or drop him at your house? Does he have any nut allergies? Because he just ate some cashew butter. I know. Listen to me. I know that's hard to hear. But it's true. It's true that if we minded child molesting less, less kids would die. That's true. Now, I don't know what to do with that information. I don't have a way to apply that to anything that's helpful. There is some sense that when you're out there looking for somebody, you're trying to spread your seed. Really, guys would like all women to just lay on the ground with their legs open, and we could just spray like a mist. Just mists of cum that then trickle down. But I'm not one of those guys who could just walk up to women and start talking to them. Like, there's guys, like, there's a lot of sinewy black guys that wear puka beads. Not hard brothers from the hood. Like, with, like, a suede vest with nothing else on. Suede vest, both nipples showing. Good stomach, puka bead necklace. You know, like those bracelets that are like just leather. And I'm getting a little hard just picturing this guy. This guy's sexy. This guy gets laid. You know when somebody sees a hot woman, there's that thing we just call a hot woman. Like, there's a lot of guys who say, how do I talk to the hot girls? Why do you want to talk to a hot girl? Why would you want to talk to somebody with a drink and go, eh? Why would you want to have that conversation? You own a landscaping business. You're incredible. You're an amazing human being. You started a landscaping business from nothing. Her, man. Find a woman, an old, kind of your age, late 30s, Jewish girl, smokes, and gives tough hand jobs. You know, I love Jewish girls. Cause they just go, come on, and they're awesome. I'm gonna suck it, all right? You ready? Totally, suck it, you dirty Jew, I love you. The hardest thing about having kids is just the days that you spend with them. That's really the hardest part. It's just every day that you have them is the hardest part of having kids. It's just every day. It's getting up, it's 6 o'clock in the morning, which first of all, I'm not that guy. 6 o'clock in the morning, I have blown off entire careers because of one day I didn't want to get out of bed. Like, I'll just not be that then. I gotta get them dressed. That's number one, because that's the one that people will notice. That's the only one. If that's the only one that I get done, I'll be okay. If I show up with two naked kids, I'll go to jail. So I have to, but I can not feed them. They're fine. They're just a little tired. It's fine. And then I gotta get them to school, which means walking. The older one goes to kindergarten. It's third grade. Jesus Christ. I just said kindergarten. She's in third grade. You know what's even worse? She's not. She's in second grade. Every day you spend with your kids is torture. And it's because I love them. If I didn't love them, I wouldn't matter. I just play poker with my friends, come home later, oh, they're dead. But I love them. I wiped my daughter's ass for the last time on May 13th of 2008. And I remember this moment, because it was a big moment in my life. Because when you have children, they start as babies and they shit all over the place. But then finally they can use a toilet, but they can't wipe their ass. So you have to wipe their ass. That's the last thing you do for your kid. That's like an intimate bathroom thing, is wipe their ass. And one day it stops. And I remember the day. I said the date, but I don't remember it now because I'm lying. Because I had always wiped her ass all that time, and it's just a thing you do. I didn't even think about it. Said, Daddy, I need a wipe! And then I come in, I'm on the phone, like, yeah, okay. So. Anyway, so I wiped her ass one day, and she said, thank you very much, Daddy. I was like, that was a little too eloquent. A thank you for somebody who I just wiped shit out of her asshole. I want to hear, like, tanke dada. I don't want to hear, like, that was very gracious of you, Father. I thank thee. I guess I feel like I should go out and get laid, but I don't have sex drive, really. It's not sex drive. I have sex just sit in the car and hope someone gets in. It's not drive. Sex drive has to come from somewhere, and it's not just about sex. Sex has something behind it, and it's weird because we ignore it. Sex is really trying to get somewhere. It's trying to have a family. You don't really want to know that because we've separated those two things. But the entire reason sex exists is to have babies. That's the only reason it exists at all. But we're such a narcissistic species that we've made it just because we just want to, like, we just want to just, it's just a weird kind of behavior. We just want to spray jizz everywhere just for no reason. Because that urge is the urge to procreate. A horny teenage boy is thinking, I want a baby. Oh, yeah. Oh, I want a precious baby of my very own to take care of. Oh, dude. Oh, look at her tits. I want her to feed my little baby with her big tits. Oh, yeah. That's what that is. But we make it this separate thing. Animals must think we're idiots. Animals that watch us have sex must be like, they don't know what he's coming on her tits. He's a moron, this guy. Woohoo, dude, just whoops. It just looks stupid to them. I have a new friend, which is weird. I'm 43. And I'm a father, I'm divorced. I have a new friend. And it makes me a little sick to my stomach. I don't like it. You ever make a new friend? When you're young, people make new friends easy because you're just young and you're fabulous. But I'm 43, and when I'm starting to make a friend, it's creepy. It's creepy. Like, I hung out with this guy who I don't know, and then I was like, I'm inside my head. I'm like, I want to see him again. I want to see this guy again. If I just let him go, I'll never see him again. I need to say something. And I felt so sick. Like, I felt so disgusting. Why did it bother me so much to say to this fella, I would like to see you again? It just, you know why? I realized it was because I was afraid he might say no. I was afraid of being rejected. So I don't want to make him say that, but I did. I said, I'd really like to hang out again. And he said, yeah, okay. And then I ate his asshole. It's my new friend. What are friends for? If you don't eat your friend's asshole out with your tongue, you're a piece of shit. You're not a friend. You're not a friend. You're a fair weather friend. You know, I went to a doctor recently and told me to eat slower. And I was like, why eat slower? And he said, because your body gets full, but that message that your body's full takes 20 minutes to travel from your stomach to your brain. It takes 20 minutes before you know that you've already been full for 20 minutes. First of all, what a douchebag your body is that it takes 20 minutes. What's taken 20 minutes to get? If I stub my toe, I know it immediately, and that's twice the distance.
What is this message doing that it like stops at my tit? Hey, tit, what's up? Hey, what are you doing? I'm going to tell them that we're full. Get up there, you idiot. We're going to get huge if you don't tell them. Oh, well, excuse me. I guess, yeah. And then he goes off. I'm not going yet. And he goes down to my asshole. He's like, hey, asshole, what are you doing? My asshole's like... That's how my asshole talks.
I mean, sometimes you see a person on the street who's in a state of life that you couldn't imagine having the courage to live. You ever seen somebody? You ever seen a person and you look at them and you go, I would just kill myself if I woke up like that. I would just kill myself. I don't have the courage. And it's a comment on me, not them. I couldn't live like that. I get to go like this. And if I had to go like this, I'd blow my brains out. I can't do it. I have only the courage for a perfect life. I really do. Anything below perfect, I ain't doing it. I ain't being one of those guys. I don't even want to be cold in the winter. You know when you see somebody, they just have a flannel shirt without a jacket, and they're just being cold and their face is purple in spots? Couldn't do it. I saw an old lady I couldn't be. I was walking behind this lady. That is a weird sentence. I saw an old lady that I couldn't be. I was walking behind her, and she had just a spine that was just dog shit. Her spine sucked ass. I'm saying this in like as her friend. Her spine sucked dick. She's just one of these people. And she's walking in front of me like this. And she had a collar on her shirt that was very high. And so I couldn't even see her head. Looked like she had no head. Just like this, with no head. And first thing I thought was, her doctor's an asshole. Because he could have told her. He could have said to her, listen, just so you know, now that you're like this, if you wear a high collar, it's spooky for people behind you. It's spooky from the back, sad from the front, and kind of funny from the side.
I'm 41 and I'm single. Not really single, just alone. But I have two children, and that's the only thing I'm comfortable with in life anymore. I know how to take care of a couple of kids.
I like French toast.
Oh, sorry, that's what we're having.
Mommy doesn't make us French toast.
Uh-huh. I go to my daughter's school to volunteer sometimes. My daughter goes to a public school. And I volunteer not because I'm a good person, but because you have to. Because nobody works there. There's just nobody there. You go into school like thousands of kids, and you go, where is any grown-up right now? And I usually go for lunch and recess. That's when they really need grown-ups, is for lunch to volunteer in the cafeteria, because they have 300 kids eating, and they have one Jamaican lady watching all of them. It doesn't matter that she's Jamaican, but it totally does, because there's nobody who can be mean to 300 children, just in the way that the Jamaican lady, and it's not her fault, she's outnumbered. 300 kids to one, Gandhi would be like, shut up! So, my job as a volunteer is to stand there, usually near my daughter, so I can be with her, and then kids raise their hand, and you need to go and help them. Now, usually they need help opening a milk, because they can't open their milks. They can't do it, because it's 2009, and we still put milk in this little paper box. Put it in a bottle. I don't know why we're doing it. It's torture. We put it in this envelope that was invented by some Dutch in 1773. And they can't do it. They can't open it. It's too subtle an idea, a design for a seven-year-old to peel back the paper and then gather it forward into a spout shape. And the glue is vicious, so they have to pick at the corner and try to get it. And they end up drinking out of this finger filth disease spout. So they can't do it, so they raise their hand and I do it for them. I'm not better at it. I deal with the stress better than they do. I don't cry like a little bitch because I can't open my milk. I'm a man.